This is Dining Table Print and Play. Today, I'm going to teach you how to make tokens. A few different ways. Previously, we've gone over making tokens with a die cutter, and that makes really, really nice tokens, but obviously, not everyone has a die cutter. And most of the time, you can get away with a steel ruler and some kind of cutter. I've got a few extra things here which we'll go into later, but don't worry, you don't necessarily need them. I've already printed out my print and play tokens on label paper, because that is the absolute easiest way to do things like this. And I've sprayed them with a glossy lacquer, which we've also covered previously. And I'm going to use either this stuff, which is backing boards for comics, which are pretty cheap, and they're very good quality cardboard, but not that thick. Or this stuff, and this is grey board, which is thicker and sturdier, not quite so readily available, and not quite so cheap. But still, a better material overall. One of the biggest problems you might have when you're making tokens is making things double-sided and having the two sides line up. But there are still a lot of games which don't actually require two-sided tokens, and a single side is just fine. So we're going to start out with that. And it's the absolute most simple option. We'll just take some label paper. I'm going to cut out just a bit of this for the demonstration. For what it's worth, these are tokens from Heiko Günther's Dune the Dice game. And we simply take our label, stick it down on some of our backing board. Here I'm using grey board because it's a good thick substrate. And then we can cut it out. So I'll use steel ruler and the rotary cutter for this because it produces nice long clean cuts. And again, there's a previous video on that if you need to brush up on rotary cutters. You could just as easily use a craft knife if you like to. Of course, it's usually a good idea to trim off just the section you're working on to start with. Makes it easier to handle and avoids wasting too much cardboard. Now, these counters are laid out in a fairly convenient way to cut. We just need to make long cuts to divide up the rows of hexes, and diagonal cuts like this divide up each individual hex once those rows are cut. Just to make this a bit easier, I'm going to make light cuts along the diagonals in advance, so that then once I've cut the strips out, I can use those light cuts to line my blade up, and I don't have to worry about carefully lining up the ruler each and every time that I want to cut one of those hexes off. So I'll start off with just making some light cuts, and that really just means doing a couple of passes fairly lightly, but not cutting all the way through. Obviously you can do this if you're doing rows of rectangular counters as well. This end cut here goes across two hexes, so I might as well just cut the entire thing off at this point. There's no registration marks on this piece to actually worry about, so no reason to keep the ends. Okay, so now I can cut this into strips, and I've already got these light cuts in between each hex to make it easier to cut them off later. I'll just get these last bits at the end here as well. The other reason to do these in advance, and these light cuts in advance, is that once you have just a strip one hex wide, it's actually a lot harder to balance the ruler on top of it and line your cuts up carefully. So there's try and do as many cuts as possible before you get too small a piece to grip your ruler down on top of. Sometimes you'll find that when you do lay your ruler down in about the right place, it tips off the back. And in that case, it's simply a case of taking some of the bits you've cut off previously, lining them up under the back of your cut so that your ruler has something to rest on. And like that, it will support the ruler, make sure that it doesn't tip while you're actually making the cut. And your overall cut will be more accurate. Now, it's just a case of taking the
strips, we've already got, if you can see, a bit of a gap we've scored in previously. So you may even be able to just drop your blade into that and make the cut by hand without using a ruler. And that's arguably the safest option, because if you've got a ruler on top, then again, you're sort of trying to balance it on top of there, line up the cut. You might actually cut slightly to the side of your original cut. So if you can just roll it through that cut without using the ruler, that's best. There's a perfectly good single-sided token. You may also prefer, now you've got these small grooves essentially to run your blade through, you may prefer to use a craft knife to make these parting cuts. Again, you'll find it much easier when you've got that first cut there to do it without a ruler. If you really want to, if you want to be absolutely certain, you can line your ruler up as best you can with your previous cut, but still, it's probably worth putting the blade of your cutter into the cut first, and then lining a ruler up against the blade of the cutter, just to make sure it's in the correct place when you do your cut. I've had a lot of practice at this, so I'm going to do it without the ruler. There we have a number of single-sided tokens ready to play. Because we were careful with our cutting, they line up pretty well. And because they're hexagons, obviously, you can tessellate them fairly neatly as well. So what do you do if you do need your tokens to be two-sided? Well, there's several ways of doing this, and it sometimes depends also a little bit on how the files come. So these files, for example, from the game Imperial Harvest, have a convenient fold line down the middle, which means that it's fairly easy to get the two sides lined up. We simply cut out a strip of these tokens, we fold that fold line, crease it in advance, similarly to the way we might have done print and play cards in the past, and then we wrap the two sides around a sheet of card. And I'm going to use the Comics backer boards for this, because when you're folding around a thin piece of card, then it's fairly easy to get the fold right down the middle of the piece of card. If you're folding against a bit of card which is really, really thick, you've got to be very careful to get that fold line perfectly on the centre of the thickness, otherwise it could be off one side or another. So to start with, we'll simply cut a strip out, crease them, and wrap them around a bit of card. As it goes, these crop marks here are shared between this strip and this strip. So when I cut out my strip, I want to go right down the middle of those crop marks to make sure that I actually keep some of the tick on both sides of the cut. Now we have to crease all along that fold line. And I find the easiest way to do this is to periodically pinch directly at the fold. And again, you may have seen this before with the cards. And then you can almost roll it back and forth with your fingers to make sure that dotted line is directly on the fold. Once you've got that all done, we can smooth out the crease between the pinches. Start with a fairly light smoothing. Once we've got it lined up all the way down, we can lay it down onto the table and finish off that crease. You can use the back of a fingernail like this. You can use the cork back of your cork back ruler if you need to. You can also get folding tools made out of bone or hardwood or even Teflon, which are also good for this. We now need to insert a bit of card in between these two sides of the fold. And we need to get it as close in there as possible, because if we don't, because our tokens are fairly close to the fold, there'll be an unsightly
crease line down there, or we'll have to cut very close to one of the sides of the tokens. So, to start with, we want to peel back the backing just on one side, all the way down. And then we've got our sticky back of the label. We've got our backing paper here, so we can slide our card in right the way up to the fold there. Try and line it up by eye right the way down there. And you probably want to line it up basically with the edge of the crease of the backing paper. And the fold will actually be a little bit this way, but that's fine because we need it to be along the edge of the card, essentially. Pull the label this way as you stick it down to try and make sure that that fold line is as close to the edge as possible. And then push the label up onto your bit of card. Make sure it's all smoothed down. And then we can flip the whole thing. Pull out the backing. And do the same thing on this side. Now, be a bit careful because it's quite easy to get this not perfectly flat because we're pulling it on. But hopefully we should end up with our tokens fairly decently stuck down and the dotted line is almost bang on the edge of the card there. It's come a little bit this way over here and it looks like it's pretty good up this end. Again, just make sure that the tokens are perfectly smoothed down on both sides. Now we need to cut them out, and because this is actually attached to a big bit of card, we can actually make all of these cuts between each token before we cut off the strip. So let's do that. If you have a grid pattern on your cutting mat, like I do, you can actually use that to help line up your cuts, because you can line up the ruler with the lines of the cutting mat and the edge of the card with the lines in the other direction. So we can get our square tokens after all. Alright, now we've made all of the cuts in between each token, we can simply line up our ruler between these last two ticks and cut them all off of the strip at once. And looking at this, I am actually going to move my ruler back from the edge a bit and make that cut down the front edge, just to clean up that side of the tokens. Most importantly, they're double-sided, and they line up fairly well. Now, obviously we've got several more strips on our paper, on our label paper. Because we've made little cuts into the edges here, if we want to lay another strip down here, we need to actually trim a little bit more off of our card here, which is a little bit wasteful, unfortunately, but that's the price you pay for getting your tokens perfectly lined up. This is a big heavy duty corner rounder, and we can simply trim off the corners of these square tokens, and you end up with something that's a lot nicer than just a square thing. It's still not perfectly round, but it's an improvement. What if you want your tokens to actually be round? Well, there's a couple of options, thankfully. One option is this kind of craft punch. It's a fairly lightweight piece of kit, so don't expect to be cutting through greyboard with it. But if you are using something so thin as this Comix backer board, then you can pretty much place the token inside it, try and get it lined up as much as possible. Unfortunately, this one isn't exactly the right size. These are 3/4 inch, I think, tokens, and this is a 7/8 inch cutter, but you can see the principle. If we line that up as nicely as we can, inside the circle is going to get cut out. And you can squeeze the cutter just a little bit until it gets pressed against the top there, and then you can see exactly where it's going to cut. And then we squeeze it until it goes right the way through. And you can see it's not a very clean way of doing it. But it eventually does cut all the way through, and you have a fairly decent round token. It's not the cleanest cut, as you can see. The edge is a little bit dented, but it gives you the nearest you're going to get to die-cut tokens without buying a big die-cutting machine.
Another way to cut round tokens from your double-sided bit of card is to use an arch punch. And this is a particular kind of metal tool. It's got a hole down the middle and a sharp edge along the bottom here. And the idea is you place it over the top of your token, lining the cutting up as much as possible. And you can kind of see down the center to line it up. And then you strike it with a big heavy hammer, like so. And that forces the blade through the cardboard. And sometimes it'll take a couple of whacks to get it all the way through. And the token just pops up the center here. And if you cut a series out, then they'll start to spill out the top of the tool. Once you're done, you can just turn it upside down, tap them through, and you have a series of fairly nicely cut card tokens. You can actually use this to cut right the way through fairly thick cardstock. It will push out the card around the cut, but the cut itself, the token in the middle, will remain fairly clean. I have used one of these to cut up to about 2-3 millimeter grey board before. There's a couple of things you have to be very careful about when using an arch punch. The first thing is to use a fairly heavy hammer, because essentially the more weight you've got in the hammer, the more mass there is, the more force you can transfer through the momentum of the hammerhead into the top of the punch. And the more force you transfer at once, the cleaner the cut, the more it goes through in one pass. The more separate hits you have to do, then generally speaking, the less clean the cut's going to be in the long run. The second thing is to use an old, scrappy, self-healing cutting mat underneath your cut, because, as you can see from the bottom of this one, it kind of makes a bit more of a mess of the cutting mat than regular, you know, knife or rotary cutter cuts do. This is bowed. I don't know if you can really make it out, but it's kind of a bit of a wobbly shape. And largely that's because this has been slammed into it so many times over and over. Every single time, because this is kind of wedge shaped, it expands the plastic sideways around the outside of the cut just a little bit, but enough to distort it over time. And inevitably some of the little bits of card that get forced down by the edge of the blade actually get trapped in the little groove that the blade makes in the cutting mat, and that will mess up future cuts if you want to make them using a knife or a rotary cutter on this cutting mat. So once you've started using it for an arch punch, it's not much good for anything else, unfortunately. So use an old scrappy one. The third really important thing with this is to do it over a really, really solid surface, and obviously not something you particularly want to keep. So the table isn't good enough, because you whack the table, you hear all that noise? That noise is reverberation. It's the table vibrating around underneath the cut. All of that vibration is absorbing the force that you put into this punch. And that every newton of force that comes out as sound when you whack the punch down is force that is not cutting through your card. So you want to go over as hard a surface as possible. A concrete floor or slab flooring from a patio or something is the best option. If you can't do that, if you have to work over a bench, then do it directly over the table leg, because like that, all of the force of the hit goes into the table leg, which, firstly, it's end grain wood, which means it's less likely to distort. You're more likely to get distortion in wood if you hit it on a side. And secondly, that force hits is transferred directly to the floor, and the floor is less likely to move.
We take our punch, line it up as best we can over one of these little tokens, and sometimes it's possible to just see down the middle and make sure that your design is centered in the punch. Other times you'll have to try and look down the side. We take our hammer, fairly strong hammer, we wait for the cat to go past,
and then we want to try and hit this as hard as we can in one blow to get all the way through that card. There we go. There's one token cut out. And if we just pop that through, we'll see it's a pretty nice cut. We've got it double-sided because we lined up the two sides using the folded sticker. It's not the quickest method, and certainly if you have a die-cutting machine, that will be faster and probably give you better results, but obviously once you've taken one, then you either line it up using the side or you pop it out each individual token so you can line up the next one. That's the downside of this method, is that it's a lot harder to actually get the individual tokens aligned. And sometimes you're not entirely sure whether you cut through, so we'll give that a second strike. As you can see, the card around the token has been sort of pushed down and pushed apart by the wedge shape of the tool. And for this reason, this works best when your tokens are actually fairly widely spaced, because if they are fairly close to each other, you'll find that the token itself, the next token over, will be damaged when you make the cut for one.
So what do you do if you want double-sided tokens, but the files that you have don't actually have a common fold line? In this case, for example, the fronts and the backs of the tokens are on different sheets of paper. Well, you could mess around for a long time with a light box, tape the two bits of paper together, and maybe still get a bit of a misalignment. What I find to be the easiest option is actually to use a ruler, measure out a larger rectangle around the outside of my tokens that is a known distance away from the cut marks, and then I can stick that down onto my card, cut that out precisely, measure the same distance on the reverse side, and then stick that to the back of my cut-out slug of card with tokens on one side. And because the card and the label for the back are exactly the same size, it's much easier to try and get those aligned perfectly. The back doesn't actually have any cut lines on it at all, so I need to check that it's actually this red area, which is the backs, is exactly the same size as the red area on the front. If it is, then obviously I can just use that as my measuring basis. And this is 98 millimeters wide, and this one is also 98 millimeters wide. This is 99 and a half tall, and this is also 99 and a half tall. These are the files from The Draugr by Todd Sanders, as it goes. So what I can do is I can use the outside of that red backing rectangle as the thing I base my measurements from. Often you'll find that there's cut lines on both sides. In the worst case, if there's no cut lines and the outer rectangle or whatever of your tokens on both sides aren't the same size, then you'll have to try and work it out based on the actual tokens themselves. For example, these tokens are clearly going to have a beige background with a red outline when they're done. And looking at the two of them, the red outline appears to be the same width on both sides, so we could even just measure from the outside edge of that beige section. Okay, so the first thing I need to do is decide how wide I'm going to make my cut. I will go for an extra 3 millimeters outside of the red area, just to make sure that I do actually get enough of the cut marks in to know where I have to cut later. And I will then make some ticks, and then draw some lines to cut along later. So I'm making a mark 3 millimeters away from the edge of the red border, all the way around. And in fact, this black one on this side just has a grey border on the other side of the tokens. So I'm going to have to... Well, there's two choices. One is I could just cut right the way precisely along the edge of this red section here, and that forms one edge of the tokens. I prefer not to do that, because I would like to define that edge of the tokens by actually cutting from checkmark to checkmark through label and cardboard at the same time, because that makes sure that the edge of the label and the edge of the card counter that the label sits on are in exactly the same place, there's no misalignment. The other option would be to print it out twice, and then just cut my red one 3 millimeters from the edge of the red here, and then cut my black tokens later,
And then obviously this area of beige here I can just stick on anywhere, it doesn't matter about the alignment. And the other option would just be to include all of them on the same bit of card when I'm lining up the fronts and backs. Obviously if I do that, I want to try and line up these corners as best I can and not worry so much about this end, because the alignment of the black tokens doesn't matter so much. I'm going to go for that one, but bear in mind if you are facing a similar decision, it is generally easier to line up the fronts and backs of a smaller block of card, a smaller label, than it is a really, really large one. So don't go overboard. I mean, in theory, I could cut the entire page and try and line up the fronts and backs of the entire page, but that's really hard to get right. Anyway, I'm going to have to just measure the entire width from one end of the red to, let's say, 3 millimeters past the last tick mark for the blacks here. Next, I just need to join up all of my tick marks. And this is going to be the line that I cut the entire cardboard section around. Now, I actually want to cut this a little bit outside of these lines. And like that, I can cut along the lines later. So I can stick this down on the card with a little bit of label outside of the line that I'm later going to cut along. And then I can then make a cut through the label and the card along these pencil lines. And that will, again, help me get as precise as possible. So here's my grey board. I just need to peel back a little bit of the label. Bear in mind, I mean, you can see through from the other side because this has been spray varnished, and that's unfortunately a characteristic of spray varnishing labels. Line it up, stick it down, pull out the backing paper, and smooth the label down as we go. And now I need to cut this section out from my... Again, I'm going to go a little bit more wide and cut roughly to start with. And then I'll come back and make those cuts much more precisely in a minute. It's going to be much more easy for me to actually make these cuts precisely now. I've just got a tiny little bit of cardboard that I can move around more easily. Okay, so I've got my card piece. I've still got the tick marks along the edge of this, so I still know exactly where to start making my cuts when I want to cut these tokens out individually. But I also know exactly how wide it is and how long it is, so I can use that to make the same measurements on the backs. And I know that I start out 3 millimeters from each edge of the red. And to get this last side over here, I just need to measure exactly how wide this is. And this is 181.5 millimeters wide. Just measure that at a couple of points just to make sure that it's not cut at a slight angle. 181.5. So I'll measure that far from each of these ticks on this side and make a tick on this side. Should find that this label is now the same width and the same height as our card with the fronts on. Obviously it's the other way around because it goes underneath. So how do we line this up? Unfortunately it's not the easiest thing to do. We need to peel a bit of the label paper backing off. And personally, I find it easy to take about a centimetre at one end. If you've seen the video on making tokens with the die cutter, then this is basically the same process. Flip this over, and we just need to align these two corners. And again, because this end, it doesn't matter so much about the alignment, I'm going to be focusing on the end where it does. So what I find easiest to do is if I place my fingers at the corner there, just on the edge of the card, and then just slide the label up to meet my fingers. Dab it down a little bit so it's stuck down enough to stay in place, but not stuck down enough that I can't take it off and reposition it if I absolutely need to. Repeat the process down here. And that's probably pretty well lined up. Let's just double check. Right the way along there, up to each corner, lined up pretty well. So now I can smooth that down. As you can see, it became a little bit misaligned as I went down the card, but the majority of these pieces are going to be lined up decently. And then I just need to cut them out. As I did previously, because I'm going to eventually cut these into strips and then cut individual tokens off of each strip, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make some light cuts, not all the way through, in one direction. Then I'll make parting cuts in the other direction, and that will make it easier for me to line up the cuts that separate each individual token right at the end, because these light cuts will already provide a groove that I can run the blade through. So these are just a couple of light passes, just to make sure that I've left a groove. It's not deep enough to actually have separated the row of tokens, because I still need these tick marks up the end here to actually line up where the other cuts go. So now I've left those grooves all the way along the rows, or the columns, I guess. I'm going to now cut down each row and separate each of the rows of tokens. And to make this final cut, to avoid my ruler tip here, I'm just going to take one of the rows I've cut previously and use it to stabilize the other side of my ruler. And now I'm ready to cut each of these out. Because I've left that little groove there, I can generally just find the channel with the blade and roll it back and forth without even using the ruler to guide it, because the previously cut groove is enough to keep the blade going in the right direction. It's actually even easier with a craft knife. You just find that slot, run the craft knife down that previous light cut a couple of times, and it separates fine. These tokens are the ones with no particular background, but up this end, we should find, if we cut a couple off, that the backs line up perfectly. There we have a number of tokens with... Oh, didn't come quite clean. A number of tokens, double-sided, at least the ones that have two sides, and lined up pretty much perfectly.
So, we've got our single-sided tokens. We've got our round tokens a couple of different ways. We have a couple of different ways of doing double-sided tokens. But they're all with cardboard. They're all, yeah, as much as they work perfectly well and match the quality in a lot of commercial board games, the nicest tokens you can possibly have, in my opinion, are wooden counters. And then we'll take the graphics from our print and play game. These are laid out fronts and backs, opposite pages. Obviously the intent is that you stick them back to back with a bit of cardboard in between. And that's what I did the first time I built this game. But now I'm going to go back and I'm going to use wooden counters. I'll cut each of the individual faces out separately, little rectangles of label. And then I'll peel them back individually, stick them either side of a wooden counter. And that's all there is to it, really. And it makes the nicest counters ever. So our first step, of course, is to... I'll just do the red ones for now. Our first step is to cut out all of the individual counters.
because these sheets only have ticks at the top and the bottom of the sheet, I'm having to keep the entire sheet intact while I cut out just one row's worth of stickers. As it goes, these are the tokens for Dark Star, which is a probably the best print-and-play game I own, I would say. It's a very thinky game, and it was described by the creator as influenced by Dune and Cosmic Encounter, from what I recall. I'm actually cutting a little bit inside the ticks on each of these, and the reason for that is that I carefully scaled the sheet and obviously got it wrong. So the size of my wooden counters is actually around about the same size as the width between the ticks there. Ideally your sticker should be a little bit smaller than the counter you're going to stick it on, because like that you have a very small border around the outside, and that's important because it means that it's much harder for the sticker to get lifted up while you're playing. If the sticker runs right the way to the edge, because wood has this sort of slightly rounded edge there, it's not a completely crisp edge, it's much easier for the edges of the sticker to get caught on your fingers as you're moving the piece around, and that means it's much more easy for the sticker to get lifted up. And obviously you don't want that, you want it to stay on there forever. You can probably see it now more easily than you could when it was in the sheet, but the gloss spray really does give these counters quite a nice sheen to them. So these are all the fronts, and we simply take a token for each one. Let's start with this Assault Cruiser, and it's just going to sit on top of the wooden token, like so. To get that to happen, I'll flip it over, and I'm going to take the point of the knife and just stab it into the paper backing of the label, but not through, just enough to lift up that backing, like so. Okay, and then I will peel that back just about that far. So you see, I've got the backing on this part, and this part, the glue is exposed. So I can slide it around on the bit which is still backed, until I've got about an even border all the way around. And then I can stick this side down. And now that's stuck down, it's all positioned. And all I need to do is just hold this side, and I can use the knife to fish out the backing. And there we have a very nice Assault Cruiser piece. And then obviously I need to find the back and stick the back on as well, but for the moment I'll just do all of the fronts. During this first set, I can use the layout for the next set down to see which back goes on which piece. So obviously the Assault has an Assault back. It should be fairly straightforward anyway. Later on, if I do need to refer, I can just flip over the ones I've already made to double check. So let's get all of these fronts done. There's all our fronts. So now I just need to cut all the backs out and repeat the process. As you can see, the backs are fairly simple. There's only actually five tokens that I need to particularly care about. Which particular counter they go on, and which way up it is. And obviously for most of these, which are completely blank, you could just skip them. I'm going to do them because I'm a completionist and I don't want some of my tokens to look a different shade of red when they get flipped over for whatever reason. Even though there's no game reason to flip them at all. That's just me. So, this is an unnecessary step for all but these five. I'm going to do it anyway. I figure if I'm going to all this effort to make a nice copy of a game, I should make the nicest copy of the game that I can. And really the great thing about this method is that while it's obviously the most expensive option, because you have to, you know, buy a load of wooden tokens, it produces the nicest tokens of all of the ways I have tried making board game counters. This way I like the most. But it's not actually the hardest. It's probably one of the easiest options. So now it's simply a matter of double checking that, yes, the assault does go on the back of the assault, the recon goes back on the recon, and so on. And then we simply find the relevant counters. There's the three recon. There's the two assault. And stick the stickers onto the back as well. The only thing it's really worth mentioning here, it's exactly the same process, is that if you care about that kind of thing, and I do, you want to make sure that the token goes on the back the same way up. So the orientation is the same, the top is still the same top. And that means obviously that once you've stuck this down and got your double-sided counter, you flip it around left to right, and it remains the same way up. And I'm going to put these backs on these just because I can, really. Good number of really nice, very handleable, because they're very easy to pick up. They stack excellently, which is a good thing because you end up stacking counters in Darkstar. And the ones which are double-sided are really nicely double-sided. And if you like this method for making double-sided tokens on wooden pieces, but you'd like to use round wooden pieces instead of square or hexagonal, then you can simply use a craft punch. Again, you need to make sure you get the right size. In this case, I've got one which is a little bit smaller than the width of the wooden piece. And then we can simply line up the icon on the inside of the craft punch window there, pop it out, straight off the label paper here. We've not backed this with anything. Two stickers, one for each side, and then we can take our craft knife, use the point of the craft knife, lift up the backing, there we go, put it back a little way, and then we can take our round piece, line the label up, press it down, pull out the remainder of the backing, and then you have a fairly nice stickered wooden token.
Obviously the limitation of wooden tokens is that they only come in a limited number of colours, but the solution is paint. So a simple sanding block, you can sand away the top layer of the paint, just enough to give it a bit of tooth. You want this to get rid of the glossy texture of the paint that's already on there, and then you can spray it with lacquer paint, with enamel paint. Outdoor paint is best because obviously it's the most durable, so if you want in purple. And you should be able to find more or less any colour you like in spray paint. The best practice, obviously, is to test it on a small piece first, so just spray one, just to make sure that there's no bad reaction with the paint or the lacquer that's already on there. And after you've sprayed it whatever colour you want, then you can give it a couple of shots with the same kind of gloss lacquer that you use for spraying your pieces or your cards, just to protect the paint job. And then you can label them up just like any other piece, and they will just expand your range of colours.